Bavaria is the southernmost state of Germany, with its capital at Munich. And we flew into Munich's modern airport the day before our tour was to begin. The Kempinski Hotel is right in the centre of Munich Airport, and we stayed here for one night. In the morning, we were met by our guide Caroline, and we drive about 2 hours southwest to Hopfen am See, where we'll be based for the week. The Landhaus Kössel is based on an old farmhouse and has a second building similar in style to the original one. Our room is very pleasant, in spite of the nearby church clock tower that chimes the hours 24 hours a day. Our balcony looks across to the Alps, and this is the view early on Monday morning. It's only a 10-minute drive from here to the village of Hohenschwangau to begin our visit to the first of King Ludwig's castles, Neuschwanstein. Building started in 1869, but was never actually completed. Ludwig was able to move in 1884, but he only spent a total of 172 days here before his death in 1886. In the style of a medieval castle, with interior decoration heavily influenced by the operas of Richard Wagner, construction materials and techniques were the latest available at the time. Today, Neuschwanstein is Germany's most visited tourist attraction, with up to 6,000 visitors a day. That's the Marienbrücke Bridge, where the best shots of the castle can be taken. Hohenschwangau, where Ludwig spent much of his childhood, and we'll be visiting this afternoon. Back down to the village by horse-drawn carriage for lunch. Looking up in one direction, Neuschwanstein Castle, and in the other, Hohenschwangau. It's quite a steep walk up to the entrance. There was a ruined medieval castle on this site, and Ludwig's father, King Maximilian II, had the castle rebuilt in the 1830s. It was used as a summer palace, and Ludwig spent a lot of his childhood here. The interior walls are decorated with murals of German history and mythology, and these images seem to have inspired Ludwig's childhood imagination. As in Neuschwanstein, though, we're not allowed to take pictures inside. A well-earned rest. There's been a lot of walking up and down steps today. And on Tuesday, we've got a lot to pack in as well, with our first stop at Zugspitze, Germany's highest mountain, which we will approach through Austria. We're getting the cable car from the Austrian side to the summit, but weather conditions are far from ideal today. On a clear day, You can see for miles, apparently. The old German and Austrian border posts are still here, but not used these days, of course. The highest beer garden in Germany. There's always coffee and cake. Rejoining our coach, and we head back into Germany, up towards Oberammergau. One thing Oberammergau is famous for is some houses painted in fairy tale scenes, and we pass some of them on the way in. It's also famous, of course, for its Passion Play, performed every 10 years in this theatre. First performed in 1634, the next production will be in 2020. In the meantime, commercial productions are performed in the theatre. Oberammergau is a busy tourist destination, with its traditional buildings, many painted with complex frescoes. This house is called the Pilatus House, after Pontius Pilate. From Oberammergau, it's a short drive to Linderhof, the only one of Ludwig's palaces to be substantially completed. The interiors of Linderhof are in an extravagant Baroque style, with lots of gilding, but we're not allowed to take pictures inside. In the grounds, the Moorish Kiosk, which was originally an exhibit at the Paris Exhibition of 1867. Ludwig bought it to indulge some fantasies of his own. Ludwig based the Venus Grotto on Act 1 of Tannhäuser. Everything is artificial. The stalagmites and stalactites are either wood or metal, covered in canvas and cement. Ludwig had operatic extracts performed down here, and it was lit by electric light in changing colours. Not bad for the 1870s. Heading back down, we pass one of the empty cisterns that used to be used to supply the fountain. Wednesday morning, and it's a long drive to Chiemsee, where we are to get the ferry from the little town of Prien to Herrenchiemsee, an island in the middle of the lake where Ludwig built one of his castles. The boat journey takes about a quarter of an hour. We took the option of the horse-drawn cart from the dock to the castle. It's no quicker than walking, but it saves your feet. The new palace was Ludwig's most ambitious project, intended to be a replica, although slightly larger, of Versailles. It was never completed, and Ludwig was able to spend only a few days here. Once again, internal photography is not permitted, but here is an image of Ludwig's version of the Hall of Mirrors from the internet. It's actually slightly larger than the original. The spectacular waterworks were turned off shortly after Ludwig's death. And over the decades, the fountains and basins fell into great disrepair. They were only restored in the mid-1990s. Back onto the boat to begin the long journey home. Thursday we were in Munich, but more of that later. On Friday it's a long drive to Mainau in Lake Constance. This involved a short ferry ride across the lake. Then a walk across a bridge in pouring rain to the island of Mainau itself. Mainau calls itself the Flower Island, but in view of the rain, we decided to head off first to the Butterfly House, where we thought it might be dry. Outside, it's still pouring rain, but we walk along the dahlia beds, which look spectacular even in this weather. The area of the island is about half a square kilometre. And it belongs to the Bernadotte family, a branch of the Swedish royal family. The children's area includes a model railway. We were due to visit Lindau on the way back, but through a combination of weather and lack of time, it was mutually agreed that we'd just stop for a short break at Meersburg, near where the ferry takes us back. Saturday's our last day altogether, and we're heading towards Lake Starnberg. But our first stop is at the Wieskirche, the church in the meadow. This is a large and very popular pilgrimage church. Many people have claimed to have had miraculous cures here. It was built around 1750 and is now a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And that's the organ that's playing on this recording. The Benedictine monastery of Andechs is also a place of pilgrimage. The present buildings date from the 18th century, but the establishment dates back to the 12th. The composer Karl Orff, who wrote Carmina Burana, is buried here. The monastery has its own brewery, and of course also places where you can consume the products of that brewery. Beer, stodgy Bavarian food, and an umpah band make the pilgrimage complete. You can also buy freshly smoked fish caught in the local lake. And so to Lake Starnberg, and the place where Ludwig and his doctor were found dead. Having been deposed by the Bavarian government on the 12th of June 1886, Ludwig was brought to a castle near here. The following evening, he went for a walk with the doctor and didn't return. Their bodies were found in the shallow water later that evening. Officially, he committed suicide by drowning, but there are many unanswered questions in the story. The night he died, his old friend, Empress Elizabeth of Austria, was staying in that house on the other side of the lake. A few years after his death, this memorial chapel was built for the king. Sunday morning, and we're going our separate ways. While most of the group are going by coach to Munich Airport, and some are going with Astrid to Venice, we're on the train to Munich for a couple of days on our own. The slow train takes 2 hours to get to Munich, and passes some beautiful alpine countryside on the way. This is Hopfensee, and Hopfen am See is down at the end of the lake. Our hotel, the Mark, is very close to Munich's main railway station. It's not the smartest area of Munich, but the hotel itself is very modern, very clean, and very trendy. The breakfast buffet was not quite as good as the Landhaus Kessel. Back to the serious business of Ludwig's castles and palaces. Nymphenburg was the summer residence of the Bavarian royal family. When building began in 1664, This was well outside the city of Munich in the countryside, but now it's well within the city suburbs. By the 1740s, the palace had acquired more or less its final shape. Our internal tour begins in the magnificent Great Hall, more or less unchanged since the 1750s. The Chinese lacquer cabinet showcases Chinese art that was popular at the time. Ludwig I commissioned this gallery of beauties to be painted, showing not only aristocratic ladies of the time, but ladies of more common birth as well. On the 25th of August, 1845, the future King Ludwig II was born in this room. Behind the palace are extensive gardens and grounds. The Palm House has a large restaurant and cafe.
Tell me, madam,
coffee and strudel are called for at this point.
Or Kuchen, as we should say.
Strudel.
And more strudel.
Vanilla sauce.
The former Royal Stables now houses the Museum of Royal Carriages. A hunting sleigh from around 1700. King Ludwig's stagecoach from 1870. This coach can have its body detached and mounted onto this sleigh. The Residenz is the main royal palace of the Bavarian royal family, and it's right in the centre of Munich. The main public entrance is on Max Joseph Platz, next to the State Opera House. Just about the first thing you see on the interior tour is this bizarre grotto made from seashells. The antiquarium is the oldest room in the Residenz, dating from the late 16th century. It was built to house a collection of antique statues, mainly Roman emperors. The Court Church of All Saints was built in the 1820s, but was virtually destroyed in the Second World War. It's been reconstructed in a much simplified form and is now used for concerts and performances. War damage to the Residenz was very extensive. Some rooms have been fully restored, some have been restored in a simpler way, and some have been remodeled and given different purposes. This is the top of the Emperor's staircase. And this is the Emperor's room. The court chapel dates from the early 17th century. The private chapel dates from the early 17th century. The walls are decorated with polished stucco to look like marble. None of this is original, it was all destroyed in the war. The Green Gallery is also a complete post-war reconstruction. The Ancestral Gallery dates from the early 18th century. The residence has several courtyards. This one is the Kaiserhof, or Emperor's Courtyard. The residence treasury has a number of interesting objects, including this crown dating from 1370 to 1380, which probably belonged to the wife of King Richard II of England. Henry's crown is said to date from 1270. The reliquary of St. George dates from the late 16th century. The crown jewels of the Kingdom of Bavaria. Bavaria became a kingdom in 1806, and these jewels were ordered from a famous French goldsmith at that time. Through the fountain court, we enter the Cuvier Theatre. The theatre was built in the 1750s, but the original building was completely destroyed by bombing in 1944. All the gilded wooden carving and furniture had been put into safe storage, however, and this has been reassembled in a brand new building on another part of the residence site. The theatre was reopened for performances in 1958. Outside now, we're facing the facade of the residence of the Königsbau wing, and opposite that is the Hofgarten, the court garden. Now a popular public park, the centrepiece is the Temple of Diana. In the background, the scaffolding-clad towers of the Theatinerkirche. On another side of the Hofgarten is the Bavarian State Chancellery, a modern building incorporating parts of a former military museum. It also includes remains of some buildings destroyed in the Second World War. Nearby, at the end of Munich's English Garden, is the Surf Wave. The Eisbach is an artificial river, a tributary of the Isar, flowing into the English Garden, and at this point, near a bridge, it forms a standing wave. Surfers have been using it since 1972. And it is officially allowed, but recommended only for experienced surfboarders. Crossing the Hofgarten and exiting by the far corner, we see another facade of the residence, and on the Odeonsplatz, the Feldherrnhalle. This was the site, in 1923, of a confrontation between the Bavarian police and Nazi demonstrators, which led to a number of deaths and the arrest and conviction of Adolf Hitler. The Theatine Church, covered in scaffolding on the outside, looks rather splendid on the inside. It dates from the late 17th century and includes the tombs of a number of members of the Wittelsbach Bavarian royal family. The Staatsoper Theatre is a reconstruction on a larger scale of the early 19th century theatre destroyed in the Second World War. The new Town Hall was built between 1867 and 1908. The tower incorporates a Glockenspiel with animated characters. The interior courtyard seems to consist mainly of restaurants, cafes, and beer halls. The building straight ahead is the Toy Museum. The Church of the Holy Spirit dates from the early 18th century, but had to be substantially rebuilt after the war. Next to the church is Munich's food market. You can buy everything here, providing it's largely sausage or cheese, or in this case, horse meat. St. Peter's Church is the oldest in the city of Munich, dating back to the 14th century. The Hofbräuhaus, or Court Brewery, dates back to 1589. It claims to be the oldest, largest, and most popular beer hall in Munich. Hitler, Lenin, and Mozart have quaffed in here. Heading back now past the town hall in the other direction, we are on Kaufingerstrasse, the main street of the old town. Embedded in the shop facade is St. Michael's Church, and behind the towers of the Frauenkirche. St. Michael's is a Jesuit church dating from the end of the 16th century. It includes several royal tombs, including that of King Ludwig II. The Frauenkirche is Munich's cathedral and was consecrated in 1494. It's built of red brick and the interior is rather plain. Back on the main street, we are approaching Karlstor, Charles Gate, what remains of one of the medieval gates to the city centre. Beyond the gate is the Palace of Justice, the main courts of Bavaria. And along the street facing us now, the main railway station, and nearby, our hotel. About 15 minutes or so walk from our hotel is Sendlinger Straße and the remarkable Baroque church of St. Johann Nepomuk. Squeezed in between the houses on this street, the church is the creation of two brothers, the Assam brothers, who built it as their private chapel. One brother was a sculptor and plasterer, the other an architect and painter, and they let their imaginations run riot. The church is popularly known as the Assam Church after the brothers, and was completed in 1746. We can continue along Sendlinger Straße towards the city centre. We eventually reach the Sendlinger Tor, one of the three remaining city gates of Munich. The morning of our last day in Munich, and we head to the Königsplatz, King's Square. This neoclassical forum was created at the beginning of the 19th century to be the cultural centre of the capital of the new kingdom of Bavaria. The buildings are in three classical orders. This one is Corinthian. The propyleum is Doric. And this is Ionic. It's an art gallery now, and there's some kind of installation involving bales made from drinking straws outside. At the eastern end of the square, the Nazis built two temples to honour the martyrs, as they saw them, of the Munich Putsch of 1923. They were blown up by the Americans at the end of the war, and the remains are now overgrown with trees, never to be disturbed. Next to one of them is the site of the Brown House, the headquarters of the National Socialist Party. On the site, the state of Bavaria is building a documentation centre for the history of National Socialism. Nearby is Caroline Place, with an obelisk that commemorates the 30,000 Bavarian dead in Napoleon's Russian campaign of 1812. Some of the post-war buildings incorporate bits of the buildings that were destroyed in the Second World War. We headed back to the area around Sendlinger Straße for a nice little lunch before it was time to get the airport bus and head back home.
Tief im Wald nur ich und du, der Herrgott drückt ein Auge zu, denn er schenkt uns ja zum Glücklichsein. Wochen